I don't even know where to start. We have had such a wonderful day. A few little miscues. My daughter with her mother lost the car keys. So as I'm standing before you tonight, we have a car positioned on the parking lot at Hardin-Simmons. We have no key to get in that car, and there is no place to get a key except Fort Worth, Texas. So I go from that little miscue to this little miscue when I wanted to upstage my president, and we go forward from there. The Bible collection was Doyle's. From beginning to the day he called Lanny Hall a few months before his death and said, let's get this rolling. And so I am a poor substitute for his passion, but I will do my best to tell you. I can only say, as I have told my children, why didn't we sit and let him tell us more about the Bibles? When he would start on his family, we would get up and we needed to go somewhere else. Now I am faced with making declaration to scholars in the room, and all I know to tell you is how Doyle got started. When I met him in 1949, and we decided in 1951 that we liked each other well enough to join our life together, and we moved into our first little apartment at Hardin-Simmons so that he could finish his senior year. I brought very little possessions with me, and he had boxes of books. He has loved the printed word as long, I suppose, as he existed, because his mother was very glad to get rid of these boxes of books that Doyle had collected. Every home we had, and in the early days, believe me, his bookcases were orange crates. Sometimes they were stacked two together. Sometimes they were stacked four together. And we redesigned all the time to make more room for more books. He loved books, always. And I'm not talking about, in general, valuable books. I'm talking about musty, out-of-print books. He loved the used bookstores, the old bookstores, rare bookstores he didn't often venture in. Until 1981. 30 years ago, next month, actually. And for about 3 or 4 years, we made several trips to London and Scotland, and in that area he had some business needs there. And so in 1981, and I can verify this, with his own notes, his own letters that he bought his first Bible. I remember the morning, as all women do when they go to London, they want a day at Harrods, a woman's mecca of shopping. And so I said, Doyle, I really want to go to Harrods today. And he said, fine, you go to Harrods. I'm going to go to the museums and old book shopping. So we separated, gathered back together in that afternoon to show each other our show and tells. And he showed me his purchase. And it was an old Bible. And I said, Doyle, I didn't know you liked old Bibles. And he said, something to the effect, I didn't either. And so that was the first one. I found a letter in his archives that he had written back to the rare book dealer in London 2 weeks after we returned home, and he said, described the Bible he had bought, and he said, could you give me the background of this Bible? I would like to know the previous owners, blah, 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 in his letter. And the bookstore owner graciously answered his letter and said, no, I'm so sorry. When these come in, they're usually bought at estate sales, and told him he could not be of any help. But this was Doyle. He wanted to know the history of anything he bought. He wanted to know, where'd this come from? That was the beginning. I read somewhere that there are three kinds of people. You've probably heard this too. There are those that make things happen. There are those that watch things happen. And there are those who wonder what happened. Well, Doyle was a bit of all three of those. And particularly in book collecting, he wanted to know what happened. And in the area of the Bibles in particular, the authenticity of the scripture was never a problem. He made that when he was 13 years old. The Bible was the Word of God. And he accepted that with the simplicity of faith. So many intellectuals want to compare and want to know all of the things that make the scripture holy. That was not Doyle's interest. He wanted to know the road from there to here. And he searched. Every time he bought one, he tried to determine, how did that happen? Now, the result of that is we have a bookcase full of historians, Josephus, all of those names that you only hear in history, trying to trace the wonderful road from the beginning of the scriptures to today. This meeting today would have thrilled his heart because he went many times to Bible conferences, Bible symposiums, some of them were called, and he would come home just thrilled with what he had learned. This Dr. Ellis would have just tickled him to death. And so I thank you for making us a part of that. The interesting thing that we as a family have found, and I honestly say this, and I'm somewhat angry with myself, we have learned more about Doyle's Bible collections since his death than we knew before his death, because we have scoured his notes. We've studied them. We knew what his wishes were. He never considered himself an owner. He was a caretaker. And someday those Bibles would be transferred to someone else to caretake. Think about all of the years, the antiquarian books. What has happened through all those years? Through wars, through pestilence, through so many things. And yet, still, we have these wonderful, wonderful treasures. One other thing about those trips to London. Remember Harrods I told you about? I wanted and bought a cashmere sweater. I had never owned one. And so I bought a wonderful, I thought, cardigan sweater on one of those trips and enjoyed wearing it that winter. Just felt so luxurious. If you ladies wear cashmere, you know what I'm saying. It's like having a kitten just rolled up next to your, I guess, a baby sheep. Isn't that where they get that? Goat or something, where that comes from. At any rate, I love that sweater. Faithfully put it up when the winter was over. The next winter, I took out my sweater. You could see from Houston to Abilene through that sweater. The Houston malls had absolutely had gourmet meals several times. And I thought of that scripture, lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust doth corrupt. You know the scripture. You know what that purchase of Doyle's was that day? A $15.99 Geneva Bible. It is now at Hardin-Simmons. Now tell me, who made the better purchase that day? You know, in closing, I would say, we can do no better than that scripture that says, the grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord stands forever. Amen, amen. And amen.